And so, here with us to begin this first session on the reconciliation of Luke's Gospel by the Temple Law.
It's lovely to be here with you this morning. This is year C, and because it's year C, all the time we're going to be reading pieces out of Luke's Gospel. So what I want to do is I want to look at the Eucharist as the sacrament of reconciliation in Luke's Gospel. And we all remember that Luke's Gospel can be very conveniently broken into three parts. The first part, which deals with the time of Jesus in Nazareth. The last part, when he has arrived in Jerusalem, runs from the arrival in Jerusalem to the ascension. And in between, we have a journey narrative, a single trip, followed by the disciples, the apprentices, those who are seeking to know how to live in his way, because they want to live the way, which takes them on a journey from Galilee down to Jerusalem. And in Luke's Gospel, more than in any of the other four, that trip is punctuated by Jesus eating with one group, telling stories of eating with another group. And all these meals, all these encounters with Jesus, are somehow to help the community to which Luke is preaching to appreciate the memory of the Last Supper, to appreciate the supper they are celebrating now as he preaches to them, and to see that supper as a preparation for the supper at the end of time, the great banquet of heaven. And for Luke, there is only one image of the destiny of the Christian, and that is the banquet of heaven, when people will be raised up from all over the world to be brothers and sisters of Abraham and to sit at the Lord's table. And the curious thing about most of the meal stories and meal events in Luke's Gospel is that they have a very strong reconciliation theme. Early on, Jesus finds himself at the meal in a Pharisee's house. And most shockingly, there is a woman present at the meal, and this woman is an impure woman. And for the Pharisee, this is a marker as to whether Jesus is a fraud or not, because he's one of those who are saying, he eats with sinners and drunkards. But for Jesus, the Pharisees' barriers are meaningless. The woman is a child of the Father, and as such is reached out to. And in that meal, rather than demonstrating division, and rather than demonstrating barriers, the Lord brings that woman into the family of God, shows that her relationship with God is deeper than the human barriers that have excluded her, and shows her to be the one to whom he is more interested than he is in the righteous Pharisee. That meal with Jesus is for that woman not only her reconciliation, but takes her into the divine presence. At the very just before they arrive in Jerusalem, there's another event. Jesus is walking along the way, and there he discovers this little man, Zacchaeus, who is the perfect example of someone who is a traitor to the covenant of Israel. Zacchaeus, and you're supposed to know that Zacchaeus had a good Jewish name like that, he should know better than what he's doing. But Zacchaeus has turned his back on the covenant insofar as that he's a tax gatherer. He has turned his back on his people insofar as he's an unjust tax gatherer, and now is excluded. The reaction of Jesus is very interesting, because we might expect that he would give him a short lecture on the immorality of being a wicked tax collector. But rather the opening words are, "Come down, because I will eat with you tonight. I will be with you or in your house tonight." Reconciliation is being brought into the table of the Lord. And then when he enters the house, Jesus does not say, "Aren't you lucky?" Rather, salvation has come to this house. To be in the presence of Jesus and to eat with him is for Zacchaeus the moment he enters into the joy of the people again. And being brought into this intimacy with the Lord, it means that Zacchaeus is invited to transform his life. And the story ends with Zacchaeus deciding to set off and to live in a new way. Discipleship is never merely an encounter with the Lord. It always has practical consequences in the way we live and in the way we present ourselves to the world around us. The world is better because of our discipleship. People are in a better position because of our discipleship. But at the very heart of Luke's gospel, what the lectionary calls the gospel within the gospel, we have the story of the prodigal son. The prodigal son is the archetypal sinner. He has an inheritance from his father, which he turns upon. That is, for the audience, that is rejecting the inheritance of Israel. That is turning your back on the covenant. He departs into the depths of impurity. So we're told he goes into a foreign place. Foreign places are impure. He wastes his money with useless people and women. More impurity. And he descends into the depths of impurity and sin to the extent that he cannot distinguish between his food and the food of swine. Returning, he comes expecting to be charged somehow for his return, and instead meets the graciousness of the Father's banquet. The banquet is not a reward for being good, and it cannot be used as a punishment for being impure or being wicked. The banquet is simply the overflowing of joy that now someone who is lost, who has been lost, is found. So the prodigal son, in returning to the father, is presented with a banquet, and the banquet is an anticipation of the banquet of heaven. Now, that might just seem a lovely story, but it challenges us to see how we see our own Eucharistic benefits. Do we really see them as our joyous expression in Christ of thanking the Father for the fact that he is the wondrous giver of all good gifts? And if he is the wondrous giver of all good gifts, do we realize that in our awareness of our thankfulness, that we must equally be aware that that which is given to us is to be shared with every other human being? Pope Francis said some time ago that we all too easily see the Eucharist as a reward for good behavior. And goodness knows the history of the church is full of people who have seen the Eucharist as some sort of prize. But what we are actually challenged to realize when we read these Eucharistic stories in Luke, and we'll be reading them Sunday after Sunday until November, is to realize that the Eucharist, far from being a prize, is the necessary food for the journey. It should surprise us with the warmth and embrace of the Father's welcome. And the Eucharist becomes the place where we become reconciled to the Father. Returning, we rejoice in his banquet. It's curious that from almost the first evidence we have of Christians celebrating the Eucharist, which is the account of what was happening in Corinth, that we find in the first letter to the Corinthians, written around 58, that the Eucharist is actually the place where Christians don't like being together. Paul faces a church in Corinth and hears about a church in Corinth, and he hears similar things later about the church in Rome, that is actually full of divisions. And we know what some of these divisions are. The Eucharist is to be the place where all become children of God. But what about a Jew sitting beside a Gentile? A Jew has no problems giving food to a Gentile, but what do you take food from a Gentile? What about the presence of a woman? See, it's okay to give food to a woman, but what about taking food from a woman? For most of the followers of Jesus at that time, the inheritance that they have of the purity laws means that the idea of taking food from either a Gentile or a woman is just simply out of the question. The risk is simply too great. So the Eucharist becomes the place where Jews want to be separate from Gentiles, but they both claim to be in the Lord. And women want to be, men want to be apart from women, but they claim to be both brothers and sisters in the Lord. But what about rich and poor? It's all very well to think of the Eucharist as a very wonderful spiritual thing. But what if it actually requires sharing with the poor? Paul is very conscious that rich people have one vision of how they're going to share, and poor people have another vision. And the rich want to do it, want to take the lead, and the poor can follow on. But for Paul, not only are they one in the Lord, but but they've got to model a new way of actually behaving with one another. And then, in a society that is riddled with slavery, and slavery is taken utterly for granted, what about, it's one thing to say you can be nice to your slave, but what if you actually have to sit beside your slave? How does that transform the relationship with your slave? It's always worth remembering that it's only small groups of Jews, such as the community in Qumran, and then the early followers of Jesus, that actually see the idea of all human beings being equal, because they are made in the image and likeness of God, as a basic principle. And if that's a basic principle, then there can be no slaves. And if we are all children of God, then we are all brothers and sisters. Just think about how we use that language whenever we gather. It always comes as a surprise to students of the French Revolution that the very first community that said, all people are free, no slaves, liberté, all human beings as being made in the image and likeness of God are equal, égalité, and therefore can be brothers and sisters as children of God, fraternité, is actually found not in the 1750s, but in the early Christian liturgy. So Paul sees the Eucharist as a great challenge for us to realize our reconciliation. Jew and Gentile have been reconciled. The divisions between men and women have been put on a par. Neither can be automatically holier or automatically impure. They must each seek the way of the Lord. Rich and poor, slave and free. As he sums it up in Galatians, Christ, there's neither Jew nor Greek, male nor female, slave nor free. So the Eucharist not only must be the practical reconciliation of all these divisions, but the Eucharist must be the ideal place where we present the new image of the people of God. We're aware that as we look around our society, most societies thrive by accentuating division. It's good there's a difference between rich and poor, because people see there's a role for reward. If you're a politician, it's very easy to get a following if you make divisions between the nice people and the dangerous people. We live in a world where the outsider is almost identical with the dangerous one. And yet, when we gather for the Eucharist, we are expected to model a society such as God wants, and in modeling that society, we are expected to feel a conflict between a reconciled society and the way we are living during the rest of the week. There can be no outsider. The only outsider is someone who would not be a child of God. Could you find such a person? There's a lovely story told in the Mishnah, Jewish document written around 160. And it's trying to deal with the idea that any group that believes that they are in a special relationship with God can very easily slip into the very false assumption, if I have a relationship with God and I belong to the special people, then everyone who doesn't belong to my people is somehow in outer darkness. And it's a story, you can see that it was told by someone who was a teacher. It's God surrounded by the angels at the time of the Exodus. And the army of Pharaoh, all his horsemen and his chariots, are being just about to drown in the Dead Sea. And the angels are all laughing. They're laughing at the good. Oh, look at all the baddies. God slaps his hands and says, stop it at once. I love each of them. They're my children too. It's curious that that very obvious lesson that God loves all, we believe that God is the creator of all life, comes from him, all life is precious because it comes from God. Every human being is precious in the eyes of God. The Spirit is moving in every human heart to discover the truth. We believe that every human being can somehow be disposed to hearing the message of the Christ. And yet we very easily slip into the holy us and the unholy them. And that's probably the greatest danger that constantly afflicts us as Christians. Because within ordinary human religion, every society has a religion. It may be called this or that, or it may be just the cult of success. I become secure in my religion by saying, I am here, and you are over there, and because you are over there, you are other than me. Bluntly, the nice people, the unnice people, the pure, the impure, the saved, the lost. And you can track that all the way around religions. Hence, most religions have at some stage sanctioned a war that said, getting rid of your enemy is just getting rid of people that are wasting space. And we take that idea, and it's somehow, we forget how alien that idea is, and it surges up within us. We forget how alien that idea is to our vision of God, and to our vision of what religion should be. We don't think of God as the supreme being in the universe, and we just happen to be on the right side. We think of God as infinitely greater than the universe, the mystery beyond the universe. The whole of the universe is in absolute dependence upon God. And therefore, every person, every human being, they cannot say, oh, well, I'm the ones who are poor for God. Everyone is a beloved creation. Everyone is a child. child of God, whether they acknowledge it or not. And our challenge is not that of them and us. Our challenge is helping those who do not become aware of their need for God, who do not give name to their need for God, to bring that to be named. Augustine begins his account of his own faith with a very interesting phrase. You, O Lord, have made us for yourself, and our hearts are restless until they rest in you. Our challenge is to find the unrestfulness in our own hearts, in the hearts of those around us, indeed in the hearts of every human being, and to show how that unrestfulness can only find genuine rest in an acknowledgement of God, and then acknowledging God in thankfulness in Christ. And in that process, when we gather for the Eucharist, we are expressing that ultimate reconciliation. When all are gathered to the Father, and all divisions have been overcome, and all barriers have been demolished, then we shall be at the banquet of heaven. In the meantime, when we gather today, tomorrow, Sunday week, for the banquet of the Eucharist, it must model this reconciliation, our reconciliation with ourselves and God, our reconciliation with our neighbor, our reconciliation with the divisions within our community, and it must send a signal out in the way it shows reconciliation, that reconciliation is the way of Christianity, and it is the way we behave in society, and it is the way we behave towards all humanity. It must also send a signal to us that when we get back from celebrating the Eucharist on Sunday morning and turn on the news or open the newspaper and we read division, hear of the fostering of division, and hear of people who are able to think they're going to progress human society through fostering division, that this fractured vision is not the vision of God, nor is it what we have been celebrating. When John presents his account of the Last Supper, three or four hours of the Last Supper in John take up nearly a third of his gospel. And at the beginning of it, he presents a very interesting action by Jesus. While at supper, Jesus got up from his place, took off his garment, bound himself around with a towel, took water, and began to wash their feet. Immediately, why are you doing this? This is breaking all our expectations. We tend to think of it as a demonstration of humility. And kings down the centuries have done it on Holy Thursday to show that really they're nice people deep down. great imperial ceremonies. Oh, look, the king is taking off his sword and his finery, and he's washing the feet of a few nobles. 10 minutes later, he puts back on his finery, and he's back in charge, and the people whose feet he's washed have now got clean feet, but they know the world has not changed. They're still subjects. I know parish priests who do it on Holy Thursday just to show that they're really servants of their community. But 5 minutes later, they're still in charge. Because we miss what that event by Jesus is telling us, and we miss the reason why John places it in the middle of the final supper. The role of washing feet was an act of welcome to a guest. The insider welcomes the outsider to their house by offering to wash their feet so that they may be pure to enter into that person's house. You can find the story already in the 18th chapter of Genesis. Abraham and the visitors come. He's preparing a feast, but in the meantime, he wants to wash their feet so that they can come into his tent. Curiously, about 200 years before the time of Jesus, when that story was being translated into Greek, the way it was read by the early Christians, Abraham doesn't offer to wash the feet himself. He offers to get a maidservant to come and wash the feet. And whether it's in a Jewish household or in a Gentile household, because whereas in a Jewish household, the idea was you can enter, I will offer to have your feet washed so that you can enter pure into my house. In a Gentile household, it was just an act of generosity. You've been walking on dusty and dirty roads. This is a chance to clean up and be comfortable. But it's always done by the lowest female slave. Just as in among free people there were braids, so among slaves there were braids. There were overseers, teachers, then people that ran businesses. Then there were the house slaves. Then there were the women house slaves. And finally there were the lowest women house slaves. That is who did the foot washing. Isn't it curious? There could be no greater practical inversion of the divisions in society than Jesus, the master, getting up from a seat at table to being on the floor to wash the feet of the apprentices, the disciples. In the new community, there is a complete inversion of the vision of power. In the Eucharistic meal, there is a complete inversion of the expectations of power. The master behaves as a slave. In the synoptics, Mark, Matthew, Luke, it doesn't take the practical shape of washing feet. It takes the form of a parable. If you would be the best, the first, the highest, then you must be as a servant to all, and you must take the bottom rung place. So again, the community, the lowest is to be put on the highest is to be put on the lowest. But the challenge that at the end of the foot washing, to go back to John, the challenge at the end of the foot washing is the line we never hear. We tend to think of it as, oh, let's imitate it. Let's have a little, role play once a year on Holy Thursday evening. And, oh well, let's get the local presbyter to play Jesus, and we'll get some people up to play the disciples, and we'll just have a little game. It's very embarrassing and it's very awkward. And people don't like doing it, and it's always the people in the parish priest who usually put a little home screw on if they want you to have their feet washed. But the answer is, if I have washed your feet, I, who am master, have washed your feet, you must wash one another's feet. Each must be prepared to wash everyone else's feet. So the community that is there gathered for the Lord's Supper is a community that not only has a vision of the new Israel and is looking forward to the great banquet of heaven, confident that the Father's love will grant them place at the table, but right now, if they're gathered at this Eucharist, they must be prepared to both be served by the rest of the community, but equally to serve the rest of the community. So this vision of the whole community washing each other's feet is actually not only a great image of reconciliation, not only a great image of all being gathered together and one in the Lord, not only a great vision of ministry within the Christian community, everyone ministering in some way to everyone else, but it's a picture of a wholly different world. The reconciled community is the paradigm for the church, and the paradigm for the service of the church to the whole of the world. Paul writing to the Corinthians lets off every rhetorical arrow he can find. They have missed the point because they're full of divisions. They think of the meal as the meal of either the pure or the nice people or the wealthy or the self-satisfied. Thank God that's never happened again. By the time that Luke is presenting meal after meal after meal on the journey narratives between Nazareth and Jerusalem, Luke is aware that the divisions are as present in his church, whichever church he happens to be preaching in, as they were at the time Paul wrote, and indeed Luke probably thinks that the divisions are endemic. There are those who think that to be present at the Lord's meal is actually the direct outcome of the fact that they've done everything they should do. Anyone who doesn't do everything they should do should be kept apart. The story of eating with the Pharisee is the reminder that that's not so. There are those who think that the meal of the Lord is so holy and so sacred that it has to be kept apart from anyone whom they are suspicious of. And they forget that it is the Lord who is going and meeting the outsider. It is the Lord who goes into Zacchaeus' house, rather than suggesting that Zacchaeus come and depart with him to somewhere else. And Zacchaeus' house, this den of thief, becomes the place into which salvation comes. But above all, the Eucharist is the place of reconciliation. Because we may not have spent all the Father's inheritance. We may not have gone off to a distant country and had a hell of a time. We may never have thought of being so impure as to share the food of the swine. But every one of us, beloved children of the Father, are also to some extent traitors to the covenant. All we can say is, and start afresh. But in starting afresh, we come to the Eucharist as the great banquet. The banquet where everyone is made welcome. Everyone is brought back and brought into the presence of the Father, where in Christ Jesus we can all rejoice. I'm going to stop a few minutes earlier because my throat is completely gone.